Hey guys, Pogo here, and welcome to the next episode of Intro to Swift. In this episode, we are going to learn about variables in Swift. Now, for those of you who have used another language before, you'll probably think that this is, you know, a variable video. You already know how variables work and you can skip it. But Swift is actually a little bit weird with its variables. There are a couple of important things, so I would definitely recommend watching this even if you know other languages, because there are a couple of strange things, and you know, it's better off to know exactly how Swift works, so when you come across the code that looks a bit strange, you'll know exactly what it looks like. So again, today we're going to be talking about variables. So what exactly is a variable? A variable is a value with a type and a name, and it has the ability to be changed. So, for example, if I had a name, if I wanted to store my name Pogo, the name of the variable would be name, you know, it's my name. The type would be a string, which means, you know, basically a word. Just anything inside of double quotes. Like, you didn't know it, but this hello world is actually a string. It's inside of double quotes. Just anything that's a word is a string. And the value would be Pogo, and I would put that in double quotes. If I wanted to store my favorite number, which is 29, the name would be number or favorite number or, you know, whatever you wanted to name it. The type would be int or integer, and the value would be 29. Now, if I wanted to store a fraction, like let's say 1/2, 0.5, the type would be a double. A double is a number that has a decimal place in it. So like 0.5. Sorry about that. So again, the variable would be named 1/2 or what, 0.5, whatever. The type would be a double, and the value would be 0.5. And finally, if you have a true or false value, that's called a boolean. So anything that's either true or false, you would put as the boolean, or I think it's might be even be bool in this language. No, yeah, it is bool. Okay, so let's try defining a variable. To start with any variable declaration, you want to use the word var. That's just telling Swift that you're defining a variable. And then we want to give it a name. So let's just write out the general pattern. It's going to be var name, and then we can say it's equal to value. And we don't have the semicolon, even though I probably will put it in by accident a few times. So for example, let's say we have var name is equal to Pogo. So I'm creating this variable, I'm calling it name, and its value is Pogo. Now, since it is a variable, I can change it at any time. I could say that my name is now equal to Noah, and that's just fine, because it's a variable. Let's say that I want to make something that is constant, something that cannot be changed. If I have a value that I want to define and I don't want it to be changeable, it would be better to store it as a constant, just to make sure that it doesn't get changed. We can use the let keyword, and in this case, after the word let, it works the exact same. So we could say let number equal 29. So now if I try to do something like number is equal to 30, that's not going to work because I'm just going to say not allowed because number is constant. And we can't change the value of number because we use the let keyword, it's a constant. It's the same thing as const or final in other languages. Now, here is where Swift gets a little bit weird. If you couldn't already tell, Swift uses something called an implicit type system. Notice I never said that name is a string or number is an int. Swift can just automatically figure that out. It works sort of like PHP, and it works the opposite of Java. In Java, I would have to say string name is equal to Pogo. Here, it can figure out that Pogo is a string because it sees that it's in double quotes. But let's say that I want to specifically state that name is, in fact, a string. If I want to let Swift know beyond a shadow of a doubt that it is, and I don't want to make it guess, I can do that. So this is kind of where it goes from implicit to a little bit, it's basically optionally explicit. It's like a hybrid, kind of interesting. So if I want to do that, I go to the name of the variable, I put a colon, and then I put the type in. In this case, it's going to be string. So now Swift knows that name is going to be a string. It was automatically able to figure that out, but we'll just go ahead and tell it. Likewise, I can say that number is an int, and now it will know that the type of number is int. Again, you don't always have to do that, but it can be interesting, or it can be helpful, I should say. Not terribly interesting. So now this is where Swift gets a little bit strange. Swift has some symbols that you can use with the types to specify different meanings. One example, or the main example, I should say, is optionals. A lot of languages have support for optionals. It means that either a value is there or a value is not there. If the value is not there, it will be nil in Swift, which is null in most other languages. It's, you know, a void. It's the absence of a variable. So in other languages like Java, Java has an optional class that will contain either null or the value. But in this case, optional is actually built right in, so we can try this out. A good example of this is a middle name. Some people have a middle name, some people don't. So if we're storing information about a person, it's safe to assume that every person has a first name, and I think it's also safe to assume that every person has a last name, but some people don't have a middle name. So let's go ahead and define an optional for middle name. That means it'll either have the name or it'll be nil. It'll just not have anything. So of course we want to use var. And again, since this is optional, we want to use var. When we use let, we need to tell it the value. It's a constant and it can't be changed. So we're going to know whether it's nil or a value. It doesn't really make sense. But in the case of a variable where it can change, we really don't know. So we'll go ahead and call this middle name. And the type, it's obviously going to be a string. But we're going to add a question mark. We're saying, basically, is there a string there? And that's how you specify that something is an optional. It's not a class like in Java. It's an actual, you know, character that you add to the end of the type. And now, you'll see that the value of this is nil. I didn't give it a value, so therefore it doesn't have a value. But let's say that I wanted to give it a value. Now, I'm not going to put my actual middle name here, but let's just say that my middle name were Alex, which I can promise you it isn't. You'll see that the type over here, it says some Alex, and basically what it's saying is this is an optional. It could have nil, or it could have a value, and in this case, it has Alex, but right now, it's actually packed into an optional. When I use that question mark, I'm saying it's an optional, and Swift isn't sure whether it has a value or not. So in order to use it, I would have to unwrap it, or it's called wrapping. It's wrapped into an optional. You know, it's in that state where it's not sure whether it's nil or a value. So I would have to say that this is a value, and I would have to do what's called unwrapping it. And I will show you in the next episode how that whole thing works. But there is one other thing. So this is an optional value, and in this case, I've assigned it a value, so it's not nil. At any point, I could, you know, assign the value to nil, and now it has the ability to be nil. If I were to do the same thing with name, it would not allow me to do that because, you know, Swift is very safe. You cannot make something nil unless you say that it has the possibility to be nil. And that's an interesting concept. But in this case, I could make middle name nil since it's an optional. It could optionally have a value. In the case of name, which is a string, it must have a string. So, you know, I could set it to be nil. Now, the last interesting thing is I said that this is wrapped. It's in that state where it's not sure which one it is, and I need to sort of unwrap it. I need to, you know, take it out of its box. It's a value, but it's stored inside of this state of, you know, not knowing, and I need to reach in there and pull it out. But there is a little bit of a different way of doing this, that you can just reach in and pull it out directly. The way that you can do this is, we'll call this middle name 2. We can use string again, and we use an exclamation point. And what that means is, let's give it a value of Alex, and let's compare. In this case, it says some Alex, and in this case, it just says Alex. An exclamation point and a question mark work pretty similarly. They're both optional. This, with the exclamation point, is optional, and with the question mark, it's also optional. So I could assign middle name a value of nil. I'll say middle name 2 is equal to nil, and that didn't give me an error because that's completely allowed. I can do that. I've said it's optional. The difference is this is wrapped. When I use a question mark, I'm wrapping it, and I need to use a special if statement in order to unwrap it, which we'll do in the next episode. In this one, it's not wrapped, so I don't need to. Now, of course, you still want to check to see if it's nil or not. You want to know if you can actually use it, but in this case, I can directly access it. You'll see the direct value of it is Alex, just like the value of this is Pogo, and then it becomes Noah. But in this case, it's wrapped, and I would have to unwrap it. I know that this might be a little bit confusing, especially if you've never used another language before, but I just wanted to introduce the ideas of an implicit type system and the love that Swift has for optionals. In the next episode, we're going to look at some conditional statements, if statements, and also loops, and then I'll show you how to deal with this question mark optional, how to unwrap it using a special kind of if statement. So as always, subscribe if you want to see more. Comment with what you want to learn. If you like this video, click the like button, and I'll see you guys soon with some more programming. Bye for now.